Hi, good evening. I think we'll start. Thanks so much for coming, what a fantastic turnout. Welcome, my name is Shumon Basar. My sincere thanks to you for coming, firstly, and to my guests this evening, to Tamara Barnett-Herrin, to Sophie Bernhard, and to Mark Fisher, and I'll do a fuller introduction to them in a very short while as we proceed. Samuel Beckett once said about James Joyce's work in progress, which would later become the novel Finnegan's Wake, that form is content and content is form. Inspired by these words, format is about the shapes that discourse takes. How has knowledge been formatted into disciplines, institutions, and into technologies? What is the grammar of how we know things in the past and today? What are the mannerisms, the archetypes, and the stereotypes of things being said? And if there are hidden politics to presentation, what exactly are there? So, when I say cover version format, what do I mean? According to the Oracle of Wikipedia, quote, in popular music, a cover version or cover song, or simply cover, is a new performance or recording of a contemporary or previously recorded, commercially released song or popular song. Question: is the cover version inextricable from the advent of recorded music made for the masses? Or did it exist before, when live was all there was to listen to? What exactly is the difference between playing Mozart, from playing a Mozart piece from a score, and playing a cover version? Is coverness inscribed into classical music in an invisible way, a way that becomes explicit thereafter in pop music? The Chicago Tribune described the term in 1952 thus: cover version, trade jargon, meaning to record a tune that looks like a potential hit on someone else's label. According to the Guinness Book of Records, the Beatles song Yesterday has been covered several million times during the 20th century. Question: is this an act of love, homage, deference, or empirical proof of the decline and the dearth and the death of imagination?
What's your name, darling?
My name is Susan Boyle.
Okay, Susan, and where are you from?
I'm from Blackburn near Bathgate, West Lothian.
It's a big town.
It's a sort of collection of, it's a collection of villages. That's a thing, yeah.
And how old are you, Susan?
I am 47. And that's just one side of me.
Okay, what's the dream?
I'm trained to be a professional singer.
And why hasn't it worked out so far, Susan?
I've never been given the chance before, but here's hoping it will change.
Okay, and who would you like to be as successful as?
Elaine Page.
Elaine Page.
What are you going to sing tonight?
I'm going to sing I Dream the Dream from the Miserables.
Okay. Big song.
Yeah? Yeah.
No. I dream of all the battles I
to those people at the back, if you want to come in, there's space at the front if you don't mind sitting on the floor, or you can squeeze up at the front here. So.
Thank you.
Up to you, thank you. All right, so would it be fair to say that we are firmly, unequivocally, fatally in the age of the cover version? Now, I mean this quite literally, and we'll get to the metaphor in a short while. Question, can you imagine the X Factor and all its derivatives the world over without the desperate-to-be-discovered contestants covering Shakira, Celine Dion, Coldplay, Robbie Williams, or, of course, famous musicals by Andrew Lloyd Webber? Seeing someone you don't know, and why would you know them? They're like the man or woman sitting next to you, serving you your tax returns or spaghetti bolognese. When you see him or her sing something that you and everyone else knows, they're less of a stranger. They're less strange. It's like they plugged into the streams of continuity that forge order in the alienating chaos of time. Time that seems to start when you're born and will die when you die. In The Myth of Eternal Return, a book by Mircea Eliade, he describes the way in which traditional culture was constantly reliving the same time again and again through ritual. Time looped, on repeat. Nothing was really that new, just attenuations of what had already happened. Jungian archetypes visually and psychologically populated a time that was constantly returning and departing. Returning and departing. Even contingency could be confirmed by eternal return. An intervention by supernatural powers, this was simply declining you of the certainty of what has already happened. And, of course, the ultimate divine intervention was the end of the universe. Eschatology, the end of time, no more cover versions. Question. Can we imagine music without cover songs? Can we imagine music's past or its future without cover songs? Did the cover version emerge out of something that happened in society, culture, subjectivity? Or did the logic of the cover version, its iteration of the different and the same, leak into other symbolic realms of our non-musical world? These are some of the dimensions of the cover version that I'm hoping we'll explore this evening. So my first guests are Tamara and Sophie. Tamara Barnett-Herrin is a London-based vocalist, writer and songwriter and performer. She was the lead vocalist for the UK electronica act Freeform Five. Her new solo album, Born to Burn, came out a few months ago in February. She's collaborated extensively with the Swiss artist Mai-Thu Perret, who's over here, at the Migros Museum Zurich, the Théâtre de Lusine in Geneva, and the Performa Festival in New York. Sophie Bernhard is a singer and composer. She created soundtracks for two animated films by the artist Vidya Gasteldon, Requilibria Generateur and Nuclearama. Sophie is also behind Laka Band, an electronic pop project, and founder of the label Mekalaka. Will you please join in welcoming Tamara and Sophie? So I've asked Tamara and Sophie to, who are both, I think importantly, not only singers but songwriters, to perform a number of covers through the evening and also play a number of covers, songs that have meant something or matter to them. And then we're going to talk around them. So I'm going to first ask Tamara to sing the first cover version. Thank you, Tamara.
Somebody, please.
Bittersweet experience of falling under the malevolent shadow of Phil Spector, the great Svengali and homicidal maniac.
And was he instrumental in their success? Did they have success before Phil Spector?
I don't think they had very much success. He sort of rearranged them and decided who was going to be the lead singer and sort of chopped and changed and screwed them over, basically. But in the process, made some beautiful songs for them. That song wasn't written by Phil Spector, though. It was written by Carole King and her then husband, who also wrote a song for them called He Hit Me and It Felt Like a Kiss, which is better known and has the same kind of hardcore, masochistic content.
And you're going to play the original in a...
Yeah, the original's much better than the original. That's a critical thing to understand, yeah. I completely changed it because I didn't want to try and do a ukulele version of, I don't know, I just completely changed it melodically and everything, so you'll hear that it's much better.
We've had you here before singing with your ukulele, so that's clearly, although your oeuvre is hardly ukulele specific.
Yeah, I know, I just chose the easiest Fisher-Price thing that I could get my head around, basically. I'm not much of a player, I compose on the piano, but it's a very easy instrument to play, and a pretty instrument too.
But when I asked you to think about cover songs, a cover, did you think about it from the perspective of what would sound good on your ukulele, or did you think about the cover song that you want to do the most, and then make it fit the ukulele?
I did that, the latter, yeah.
And why this song for you, as a songwriter, or as a song listener?
I always liked He Hit Me and It Felt Like a Kiss. That's a totally legendary, amazing song. But this one was less well known. I hadn't heard it either. I was sort of scrolling through and I thought, oh, maybe I'll do this one instead. It's a super cool, emotional song, right? It's what pop does best. Sort of love you but fuck you. All of those kinds of feelings are in that song. And I also think it's important to notice that Carole King, who wrote it, she wrote it with her then husband. She wrote millions and millions and millions of hit records and was also a really famous singer in her own, became a really famous singer in her own right. So there's something about the fact that great singers write great songs. Yeah? Or great writers are great singers. The two things sometimes are really linked. Sophie and me were talking about Prince earlier before we started. And you can think of pop as one big cover. I mean, I sort of do think all of pop is a cover because of that kind of continuum and that sort of tension between writer and singer and finding them in the same person. Kathy Dennis wrote Can't Get You Out of My Head. So Kylie Minogue was covering a Kathy Dennis song when she had a hit record with that number, right? It's like that with the Carole King connection and the crystals.
So would it be fair to say that in your mind there's nothing, the cover is not an inferior category of musical performance?
I count lots of different things as covers, remixes are covers,
yeah.
Or edit, disco edits are covers, I don't think a cover version is just another version of yesterday.
Should we listen to...
Do you want to listen to the original? You can have the great pleasure of that, yes.
Wanna
you mind if I disclose?
No, you can't ask me to do anything else.
No. Ooh, rock and roll rage. I'm going to disclose the fact that Tamara's not getting that much sleep at the moment. She has an 8-week old baby. So I'm even more grateful given these incredible circumstances for that song. So, Sophie, perhaps we could ask you maybe to sing your cover version, and then we can have a little chat.
And it's a little bit of a stunt on the singing point of view, so it was a little bit of a challenge for me.
Had you sang it before, or was this?
No, it's the first time, and I messed it completely at the beginning.
We couldn't.
Now I'm going to make you listen to the original, but before I do that, I'd like to say that. For me, a cover version is interesting when it brings you somewhere else than the original. And I think Tamara, you did actually bring us
totally somewhere else. And so that's, you know, that's a success in my view. So the song I sang was first composed in the 60s and sung by Mina, who's a very popular Italian singer.
And it reminds me of the fact that, I mean, you, the music that you write and you produce and you sing is distinctively electronic, which suggests, and obviously your version, therefore, of that version, which presumably was partly orchestral and with live instruments,
yes.
Suggests that one of the things about the cover is a kind of, one reason to do it is to shift the technological genre, perhaps, right? From from one mode to the other. And I think later with Mark we might be talking about kind of fantasies of almost going the other way, where you take a very heavily synthetic song and then strip it back. But you've almost done the other direction. So, but have you done any other cover versions in terms of? Have either of you released cover versions, albums or?
I think I did. We did a version of Last Christmas for a Christmas party. That was quite fun. Which ended in like a sort of dissonant guitar and me sort of intoning the words like it was a sort of death knell. that was super fun actually. We always tried to find a cover version to do with Freeform Five,
yeah.
But we could never agree. This is the problem of being in a band. You're in a dysfunctional family unit, and no one can come up with an idea that everyone else likes.
But that the dissonant wham suggests that one, because I guess one question that will keep coming up perhaps this evening is what makes a good cover version and what makes a bad cover version, and perhaps what is the impulse to do it. And you suggest that one, I think, good criteria, which is that a cover version should take you somewhere else. The idea of doing a cover version that produces exactly the same seems a strange thing, a pointless thing to do. But
there's a thing of doing something completely different, and there's also the kind of cover version which is the same but not the same.
Mm.
And when that's good, then it's amazing. Like the Talking Heads version of Take Me to the River, or like there's a Creedence Clearwater Revival did all these like funk jam versions of R&B songs as well, like crossing not only genre but sort of racial divides as well in American pop music, which was obviously very segregated and kind of still is. That's always cool when someone gets it really right and it's basically the same arrangement, the same feeling, you know, all of the same components are there, but it's a completely different band doing that song. Then it has a sort of symbolic value when it's a success. It's kind of like, you know, we're all in this together, guys. We don't need to be on separate sides of the fence.
And I'm trying to think of analogies, let's say, in visual arts world, where certainly during a certain period of time, and we can go back to the Renaissance, to the atelier of the grand masters, there was a sense in which your education and your training was partly predicated in imitation, in literally, if you worked in Rubens, in the Triton, and in fact, of course, many of those great paintings are actually composites, painted by étages in their studio, and then the Grand Master will do the inimitable highlights on the hand or something like this. But there is that tradition, I guess, of that imitation is a key stage to learning one's craft. Would you say, does that apply to the craft and the training of a songwriter and a singer? Is there a sense in which cover versions or singing the songs that either you love or the world loves is an important part of your personal journey early on in your career?
I made an effort to learn songs. Like, I thought it was important that I would be able to sing one of my favourite songs and know all the words and stuff like that. I think in the sort of tradition and culture of pop music, there's a sense that you have to make the standard your own. So like in folk music, for example, everyone sings Hank Williams songs or everyone sings Pete Seeger songs, but of course the greatest Pete Seeger song is the one he wrote for his wife, Penny Seeger, but it's the best version of it is Roberta Flack's version, and it's every time I was the first time I saw your face, right? So it's like that thing of making the standard yours is super important, but I think, like you were saying before we kicked off tonight, all of those traditions are sort of crumbling now that we have this sort of flattening of musical space and time with the internet, and technology is completely changing that sense that you have to take tradition and take culture in your back pocket and make it your own.
I think it touches the notion of originality somehow, and maybe there's no point, or originality is not that important, but probably what the cover version tells. I'm not really sure how to elaborate that, but I have this
idea. Fantastic. We're going to come back to you at the end of the session. So for the moment, will you join me in thanking Tamara? So perhaps cover versions are a pure format of comfort against the threat of time, comfort in the past, the present as a calibration of the past. If it's homage, it can eclipse the so-called original. Listen to Jimi Hendrix's version of All Along the Watchtower, or this Mortal Coil's version of Tim Buckley's Song to the Siren. If it's homicide, then it's also patricide. Here's Sid Vicious killing Frank Sinatra with his version of My Way. Cover version smears its snot over their safe suburban parents by pulverizing their beloved songs. It's like the opposite of having sex with your parents, whatever the hell that is. Think about it. Question: are cover bands cowardly? What's the relationship between weddings and cover songs? Superstition, augury, a refusal to imagine this is now, we are here. Is nostalgia a hypochondria of the heart, as its etymology implies? Or is nostalgia a kind of soundtrack, to use a phrase that Mark Fisher has written about, a soundtrack to capitalist realism? There is no other way forward than this, it suggests. So shut up, enjoy your symptomatic recursions to the past. It's all you deserve, you bitch consumer. And please don't forget to vote for your favorite act. Calls cost €10,000 per minute, and all proceeds go to Simon Cowell's hairdresser and Sinita's bikini waxer. So, at this point, I'd like to introduce my next guest. I'm really very, very happy and thrilled that he's able to join us. Mark Fisher is the author of Capitalist Realism and of the forthcoming book, Ghosts of My Life, which is a great title. He writes regularly for Film Quarterly, Sight and Sound, and The Wire. He teaches at Goldsmiths, University of London, University of East London, and City Literary Institute. Under the pseudonym K-Punk, Mark has been one of the leading, if not the leading, thinker on the relationship between contemporary music and its hauntological excursions into the past. I really couldn't think of anyone better to reflect on our compulsion to make and consume cover versions. So will you please join me in welcoming Mark Fisher.
Okay, I'm going to start with an anecdote, which is true. It's not that amazing, but the fact it's true is not, also not that amazing. A few years ago, I was walking through Blue Water. Is that right?
Can we hear?
A few years ago, I was walking through Blue Water Shopping Centre. And I heard Amy Winehouse's version of Valerie. Now, I sort of only sort of vaguely heard it, so I couldn't pick up the full textual detail. That song, that track was not attributed to Amy Winehouse, was it? It was attributed to the posh twit producer, Mark Ronson. But I believe that's not the name. I think they're significant, actually, that was a producer. When I first heard it, I thought, oh, okay. I thought that song was by the Zootons, you know, that dreadful indie ploddies. But obviously, it wasn't by the Zootons, I thought, in this immediate moment here, the Amy Winehouse version. Evidently, there was a 60s soul song called Valerie, which the Zootons had covered. Of course, when you listen closely to the Amy Winehouse song and the Mark Ronson production, you realise that it couldn't possibly have come out in the 60s, actually. But what interested me about that initial moment was the fact that mistake could be made, and the strange kind of temporality that is implied by that mistake. The fact that you could have something produced in, I'm not sure what year it is, was it 2007, something, middle of the first decade of the 21st century, which you could mistake on initial hearing for something that came out in the 60s. This strikes me, it struck me then and strikes me now really as indicative of the kind of temporal malaise that we're now in. The phrase that I have summed this up is, there are non-times as well as non-places. But it's perhaps fitting that I heard that version of Valerie in a shopping centre, which is one of the examples of what has been described as a non-place, these places which are non-distinguishable, it could be anywhere in the world. And I think increasingly we can be anywhere, any way in time, in the same way. Just as if you enter into a shopping mall, you could be in any city in the world. So increasingly with music, we could be at any period of time in history. I don't think that could have been, that was the case really up until the 90s, and certainly between the 60s and the 90s. Music was popular music in particular, was dance status. And not only could you identify music by its sort of year, you could often identify within a few months. And you didn't have to be any kind of expert to go do that. What we found, I think, the 21st century, which in many ways has failed to happen, failed to get it. A sound of the 21st century, actually, is that has fallen away, and that's possibly related to the kind of flattening that Tamara talked about. But because of the internet, there's also a kind of temporal flattening, a dehistoricization, where tracks could come from more or less any point of musical history. All of which is to say then that I could agree with what Andrew Schumann said, that this is the colour version era, and not necessarily in a good way. I think probably the inverse case of the Bowie phenomenon is things which sound like they must be cover versions but actually are new songs. And the example I'm going to give isn't quite that, but it's similar, which was when I first heard the Arctic Monkeys, and which was actually Looks Good on the Dance Floor. And I actually did believe, I actually genuinely believe, that this track had come from 1980. And there's very little in it, in the text, the sound, or even the lyrics, which would dissuade me from that view. When I came out, nearly 30 years after 1980, I think again that's the thing they had. When they were all together.
Fame Academy.
Didn't they sort of try and write their own songs in that one?
I think
but it's interesting that sort of failed.
It failed.
I think in many ways they'll sort of sum up the non-contemporaneity of contemporary culture. You have as something, it's interesting that kind of you use that Sid Vicious cover of My Way. And, something you really couldn't have got away with, I think, in the 70s. This refloating of this decrepit, ultra-conservative kind of formula of the talent show. Of course, there were talent shows in the 70s, but they didn't have any sort of, didn't have quite a kind of cool, youthful veneer, actually, that strangely the X Factor has got. And I guess what was clever about extractor, etc., is the ability to kind of give a new technological gilding to effectively its very old conservative format. But the technological gilding is not in the actual content of the songs or how we hear the songs, but in the in the feedback relations. Exactly what you said. We become part of the program via our voting, etc. This kind of coercion then is a mode of capture of desire of aspiration. It's an art of emoting, strenuous effort, conspicuous technique, and magical voluntarism. If I want this enough, I can get it. This sort of contestants always seem to think it's relevant that they want to win. Of course they think they win.
It's the most important thing in their life.
Yeah, it's the most important thing. I just died for one to come along, so I don't really care.
I don't give a shit.
I don't care at all. It'd be nice to win, but it's not really hard. We saw what happens if you don't have the right. We saw what happened with it, I think, last week with Andy Murray to some extent. If you step outside the agreed mode, the agreed kind of emotional bandwidth that's now demanded from the public figures, and of course, I think that this is part of a kind of conservative fallback in the role of the kind of musicians in the music industry. The industry, the singers, have become industry mannequins, where there's sort of certain zones of freedom and autonomy that the musicians once had, I think, are much more constricted than they used to be. And in many ways, there's a kind of analogy between the singers on X Factor and the kind of fate of Labour, not Labour Party, but Labour workers in general. Singers with their cover versions are the equivalent of kind of call centre workers, condemned to read out the script and with only very sort of narrowly permitted sort of degrees of deviation. I think then, so these two oppressive modes of cover version. The first, both of those I think are marked by a certain performance of authenticity. A performance of authenticity which is not necessarily convincing as authentic. Then there's a kind of older mode of oppressive cover version, I think, associated really with rocking up the original. And I think this is more a kind of travesty of the original. There's no better of an example of that for me, which is to say there's nothing worse than this, which I think, for me, the worst cover I've ever heard, which is the Future Heads clod-hopping, lager-sodden demolition of Kate Bush's Hands of Love, which I hope you're not going to hear it.
I'm
going to
break.
It's absolutely horrendous. I mean, and I think closely related to this genre of sort of rocking up something, is Alien Ant Farm's version of Michael Jackson's Smooth Criminal. And in many ways, this is a kind of masculine counterpart to the this kind of feminine whimsy that I referred to earlier. Where that kind of whimsy produces a kind of weightless prissiness. This rocking up proceeds by way of a kind of lumbering heaviness. All the suppleness is hammered out of the song, the body of the song, which now seems crudely riveted together, its joints stiff, its movements ungainly but loud, like a robot from 1950s science fiction. Not unrelated to what I was saying earlier about the failure of innovation and newness in the last decade. I mean, that's not to say music culture has not changed, it's changed out of recognition, but how it's changed is really to do with the consumption distribution of music, not to do with the content. And, you know, it's precisely this regime of property, and it's hard to imagine, isn't it? It's hard to imagine recorded music being much of a commodity at all in a decade's time, really. I mean, already, I think, if you look at the actual sales figures, they're very much generational dividers. People over 40 really continue to buy recorded music in significant numbers. Or CDs, in a way, MP3s are the vanishing medium towards decommodification altogether. So, you know, for there to be a conversion, it implies an ownership, or both an ownership, either literal or figurative, I think, of a song, and the concept of original, as we've already heard. But that concept of what original is much harder to specify than first appearing. I mean, clearly the concept of a cover version is meaningless when songs were circulated as kind of endlessly mutating folk traces in the era before recorded music, which is most of the history of music, evidently. And this was a time when music was always performed live. So what is it that makes something original? I think in the sort of post-Beatles era, when the performer and the writer coincided, it's relatively easy to identify the original performance of something else. When the writer of the song performs it for the first time. But I think these examples are working together, like with Kathy Dennis and Carole King, etc. Show that when the writer isn't the same as the singer who first becomes known for performing it, that this is much more complicated. I think Kylie Minogue, it does the original of Can't Get You Out of My Head, even though Kathy Dennis wrote it. It's more problematic than that in the context of the song and performer distinct, but the song was from the start intended for multiple voices. That is to say, it was intended for no voice in particular. Tin Pan Alley, one of the early stages of 20th century music, that was how songs were produced. In the kind of quasi-industrial conditions or sort of craft conditions that sort of adorn our famous big prize and attack on popular music. In such cases, what is then that would constitute the original? The original seems to be just a matter of sort of chronological precedence, that it's whoever the first wrote that can be said to claim the original. Or can we talk of does it make sense to talk of the original at all in these conditions? I think it's making questions. I think another issue about cover versions is, are they cover versions always cover versions of songs? What I mean by this, does it make sense to talk about cover versions of instrumentals? If not, then the cover version is always about displacement of a voice. And that's why I think that I'd want to say that it's the original is to do with the recorded version, not to do with who wrote it actually. Mm-hmm. And that, so the cover, what makes something as a cover, is that it's displacing an already existing recorded version for me. This involves the kind of the disarticulation of a song from a particular voice. One way we can see that is a cover version allowing the song to escape a particular recording or a particular performance. So it reveals these as provisional and restores the song to a condition of what you might call versionality. So the song, instead of appearing as something definitive, the performance, instead of appearing definitive, becomes a version. So what is it that makes a good cover version? I'm not sure I can answer this very generically. Brian Ferry compared the cover version to Duchamp's found objects. Cover versions, instead, were like red remains which could be manipulated by the artist's singer. This doesn't tell us anything about what a good cover would be like, or how the ready-made song is sort of redeployed. So one question would be, should the cover, if it's a good cover, efface the original and all the other previous versions? Should it, that's to say, propose itself as if it were the original, contriving to make us forget that the original existed, and seducing us into the illusion of kind of presence, that we're really hearing this as if for the first time. The cover version then becomes, if not the original, then the definitive version, the standard. The thing that is the case with My Way, which Sinatra was not a first recorder. And this will be the cover's the strongest, which is to say the most aggressive, take on this idea of the anxiety of influence developed by the literary critic Harold Bloom, who argued that a lot of the way culture develops is by what he's talking about, poets, particularly sort of younger new poets struggling against the shadow of the influence, of the most dominant influence. And you know, weak poets would succumb to the influence, would never overcome the influences which formed them. They would just be pastiches of the key figures in their sort of formative life. But strong poets would, in their struggle with their formative influences, develop something new. But this first version then will be to cover as the obliteration of all other versions. But also, what's involved in that then is a kind of denial of the status of the cover itself. The cover is trying to airbrush out its own position as a cover version. We can think of perhaps another version of the cover to that, which will be one that doesn't go undercover, as it were, disguising itself as an original, but which, on the contrary, revels in its status as a kind of urban art. A cover that announces itself as a cover as such. The enjoyment of this cover consists in a kind of double hearing, when we are invited to hear the original sort of alongside or shadowed behind the new version, precisely through the cover's deviation from the original. The enjoyment in this case then resides not in the effacement of the original, but in the tension between the original and the new version. A tension we might hear in kind of gender slippage, which can open up a new perspective in or on the song. A good example of this is Grace Jones's version of George Mission, She's Lost Control on Me, in which the object becomes the subject, without in many ways ceasing to be an object. The third person becomes the first person, the she of Joy Division becomes the I of Grace Jones. And she's, instead of she's lost control, she starts to say, I lost control. And I think Grace Jones's best work, and often not love that, is cover version, actually. I think she does this found object theme better and better than most of all. And it consists in a kind of paradoxical exploration of the question of what if the object would have sang. Particularly in this quote. And perhaps one way of thinking of the best covers are those which expose the song as a kind of object, perhaps in the terms of object-oriented philosophy. Well, what had seemed sort of fixed, broken, and exhausted is suddenly revealed to have untapped subterranean depths. And we can see the cover as a fidelity to the song as a kind of body that organs, or a field of potentials, which are always closed down whenever a field of potentials or virtualities, which are always closed down in a particular case of actualization. And the cover then would be opening up the song again and pointing us back to these virtualities. There will be a cover insofar as it is drawing some attention to itself as a cover and not offering itself up as the new definitive version. Okay.
Thank you.
Can I just have one question, and then we're going to end with a couple of more performances from Tamara and Sophie. But could you say something, when you were developing this notion of the hauntological in music,
yeah.
Did the cover, was the cover version, was it instrumental in thinking about the hauntological or not? I'm just wondering.
A lot of the key cases of what I do ontological music would have been cover versions. I think for me what marks out as the ontological as a sort of distinctive moment of sort of early 21st century music is that it highlights this crisis of temporality there. Rather than it being about a direct reference to the past, there would be something which would call up something from the past, at the same time as showing that inadequate. You know, so there would be an example, the classic example is music of burial, I think, but music of burial is heavily rooted in 90s dance culture. But you know, it feels like kind of spectral versions of that dance culture. As if you're hearing, the rain and seeing the kind of deserted warehouse where the rage took place, been turned into a car park now at the same time in a way. So for me, it's that the reason why ontology was important because it's attested to the fact that we've reached this temporal impasse, but it hadn't kind of acquiesced to that. It was trying to struggle for a version of the future, even though it couldn't actually articulate it, because it's not possible to just ex nihilo by an act of will bring back the future. So,
I thought your example of Arctic monkeys was kind of interesting. This notion of thinking that it's a cover, but it's not.
It might as well be a cover.
It's almost like a body without organ, a cover version without the original.
Yeah.
Almost, right? So,
I think the status of the cover version changed. If we're in the era of the cover version, it's increasingly there's nothing to compare that to. Because the issue is a kind of formal nostalgia, not a psychological nostalgia. Mm. So you know, if you've got covers and you've got ostensibly new songs, which has retained the same kind of formal and textual qualities of those covers, then you don't achieve contemporaneity simply by virtue of having an ostensibly new song. Rather, maybe it is contemporary, it's not new.
Fantastic. Okay, we hurtle towards the end of this evening, so I'm going to ask Sophie and Tamara to play us one more cover version each. So perhaps we'll start with you, Tamara. Who and what?
It's a song written by Tom Waits and Kathleen Brennan called Coney Island Baby for a show, a production of Wojciech, directed by Bob Wilson. And I chose it because it's a beautiful song I love to sing, and because it's also the title of a really awesome record by Lou Reed. And the title of a record by a white doo-wop, male doo-wop band, I think called The Diamonds. And I really like the idea that all these different people dream the same dream, you know, like, woke up one morning and thought, coming on a baby, that's a good title. And I think that there's something about a kind of, like, consciousness pool that if you work hard enough at pop writing, you all plug into the same metaphors, you all plug into the same language. Although the songs are all kind of totally different in content, they all have this kind of mystical idea at the heart of them.
Can we maybe listen to a little bit? Do you have the original?
Yeah.
Apparently there's a recently Nana of 99 Red Balloons did an entire version where she did cover versions of her previous songs. So I don't know what you think about that. Where you cover yourself.
They
re-recorded it. And Sophie, I think you're going to, not necessarily, but you're going to share with us.
I just wanted to react about that.
Yeah.
Have you ever gone to a gig, a concert of an artist you know the work of, and you feel slightly cheated when they play a song you particularly like because, you know, they're maybe touring the whole world and they don't have enough money, so they kind of strip the whole song down and it doesn't feel like the true thing. So you can cover yourself as well. I was just as I was listening to you, thinking about the ritornello, and about what you are saying about that pop is a massive cover version. Yeah, maybe it's just enacting the there's a shift in authorship. It's more sharing. And I feel comfortable with a song being even badly covered, even though I prefer not a song to be badly covered. But sometimes you need to kill the fathers, and it's good to that someone very young just makes a mess with a song, just proposes. Maybe even not intentionally something really different. I like this idea.
Yeah. Or like The Fall, who perennially cover sort of random songs, everything from Sister Sledge to to Jerusalem, and that's just part of their so that's now become part of their identity, that there will be covers in at The Fall show.
So was there any song that you wanted to maybe play, and we can end with?
I can play just a little bit of one song and then its cover.
Tuesday, commentary format, so if you're free, please come along, it will also be uploaded.